Hello, I'm Rick Love for Sonoma TV here at the 25th International Film Festival, and I'm here with director Lisa Hurwitz, who has brought her film The Automat to the festival. It's a documentary feature, a history of Horn and Hard Art, the Manhattan and Philadelphia-based chain of vending machine-style restaurants The Automat was synonymous with. So my dad loved The Automat, and my mom didn't allow me to eat at the Automat the one time I was in Times Square at Horn and Hard Art.
What was her reason?
Food safety. She's a dietitian. And then we're talking about the Automat at St. Mark's Place. My wife wouldn't allow me to eat there. So for people who don't know, the Automat was like a giant vending machine, but you could get a full meal out of it.
I think you need to go on one of those TV shows where you swap a relative.
There you go, yeah. Because the Automats were safe and they were hugely, hugely popular. And that's the focus of your film. So food safety was obviously not a problem.
That was why cafeterias came into existence. Women had entered the workforce in the early 1900s in New York City and Philadelphia. They were stenographers. They were working in offices, and they needed a place to be able to go to eat that was appropriate for them. Women were not eating on their own before this point. They had to go out with a man accompanying her. So cafeterias were women's restaurants. They were sterile, they were white, they were tile, they were marble, and I think your dietitian wife got it
mother.
A little wrong,
mother.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Plus, they were in their individual compartments. Nobody was going to sneeze or cough on them. It, you know, not like a buffet table.
Right, and it wasn't like a vending machine where the pot roast has been sitting there since last week. I mean, obviously, it's ordered and it's put right there. Were people given tickets? Is that how they knew which door to open to get their food?
So the cubbies had a little label next to them that would say what was inside, and additionally, you literally would look right in, and that was part of the appeal. You could see exactly what you were going to eat and choose yourself. There was no surprise. It was what you saw.
One of the fascinating things about your film, and congratulations on the research job. I mean, you found descendants of Hard Art and professional heirs of Horn. Were these people, when you found them, were they aware of what their forebears had created, this beloved institution?
Were they aware? What
did
do you mean?
Did they know what Grandpa had done back in the crazy old days?
So the Horns and the Hard Arts are very much aware and proud of the legacy of their families.
Good, as they should be.
The Hard Art family is giant. I would not be surprised if here in Sonoma, during the audience Q&A, somebody raises their hand and says, "Hi, I'm the great-great, you know, granddaughter of Frank Hard Art." It keeps happening. So, but they're really happy that there was a book before The Automat that was co-written by Marianne Hard Art, who was a great-granddaughter, and now that there's a film, it's been really nice. There's some, you know, teenage Hard Arts that have been showing up, and that, you know, for them to be able to kind of fully comprehend the family, you know, legacy, they're really excited.
One of the things that comes forward in your film is during the 60s and 70s, Automats had been around a lot longer than that, but in a very tumultuous time where the nation was even more divided than it is today, the Automat was a place where you could have rich people and poor people, and you could have people of all different races. What do you suppose that was about it that made it such an inclusive place?
Well, it was inherently inclusive. You didn't have to order a full meal to go there, and there was no time limit on how long you could sit in a table. Anyone could go inside, and then, of course, there was free water. There was free ketchup, free lemons, so people would make lemonade or tomato soup for themselves. People could bring in a brown bag lunch even and hang out in there. They were not the only, you know, integrated place that was very diverse of their time, but because they were so large and widespread, they really became representatives of what it meant to be in the North and integrated. And to this day, one of the, you know, most important pieces is about diversity of the Horn and Hard Art story.
Yeah, it's amazing to see, and I think that's a key to getting so many of your amazing contributors. Mel Brooks, Colin Powell, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, Elliot Gould. Did you just say Automat and they said, I'm in? Was it that much a beloved place?
It was not that hard to get people involved, but I did contact a lot of people and get a lot of, you know, non-responses or no's in order to, you know, get that group. But as you can see in the film, they really love it.
It's a very auspicious group, and it's not, it's clearly not just a restaurant to them. It really meant something bigger to them, because for most of them in their youth, I mean, Colin Powell especially seems very moved by his times in the Automat.
And the irony is that when I first contacted him, I got a no with an explanation that he didn't think he would have enough to contribute. And it was very much the opposite. And so when I met him, I asked him at the end of this interview, why did you write me back that you didn't have enough to say? And he says, well, that's one of the things I say. I get
everybody,
so many requests.
Everybody gets a no first.
So I wrote him a second time saying, please, like, just a couple sentences would make a huge difference. And actually, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, she did the same thing. The first response I got from her was, I love the Automat, but I'm not sure if I'm going to have enough to say to make it worth your while.
And Mel Brooks went as far to record a theme song, you know, bringing in an orchestra to do it. He did that all on his own?
Well, I brought in the orchestra.
Oh, okay. He wrote the music.
He wrote the lyrics, he wrote the music, and that is his voice, and it's an incredible song. I feel so lucky that he wrote it for the film.
Yeah, I mean, that's a lot more than, I've talked to a lot of documentarians today, and you're the first one who, one of their subjects, wrote a theme song for the movie. Must be very gratifying for you.
Well, I had to ask for it, but it wasn't, after I asked, you know, he said yes, and it was sort of just a matter of, you know, time getting it done.
He
was incredibly generous and very passionate, and I think he saw in me, because he, you know, we don't really get into that in like the interview footage that you see in the film. He's curious why I'm interested, and he's very, you know, forthcoming, but there's also this element of he was impressed by, you know, my commitment and my knowledge, and that I was doing a good job. He, you know, along the way, he watched cuts of the film. So, you know, he's invested in this, and, you know, now that he has seen the finished film and he has seen how we're using the song, and, you know, it's our trailer, it's a music video, it's the end credits. And on top of that, the film it's poignant. It's about more than just the Automat. And so I know, because he has told me, but he's just really thrilled with the way that we used the song and what we ended up doing with the film.
Well, and as for so many of your subjects, it's clearly more than just a restaurant. Question that doesn't apply to many of their filmmakers here, but you've got a 96% Rotten Tomatoes rating. You're about to open theatrically here in Sonoma County. How much does that help you, having that critical support? Is it a big deal, or is it just kind of nice to have?
Up until a few days ago, it was a 100% rating on Rotten Tomatoes. There's one crabby reviewer.
Yeah, that's funny. That's very funny. But a New York Times review? Nobody I've spoken to today has a New York Times review.
No, and in fact, we were in the New York Times 2 days in a row. The review came out on Friday, and then in the Saturday paper, there was a half-page interview with me, along with, you know, a portrait of me. It was unreal, really.
That is,
and then on top of that, in the same two-day period, you know, we were in huge in print in the, well, I live in New York City, so I just walked across, you know, you have everything you need on your block in New York. So I just walk across the street to the newsstand, because yes, we still have newsstands in New York, and, you know, bought up all my papers, and it was nuts.
Incredible. Absolutely incredible. Congratulations.
Thank you.
The film is The Automat, and where are you going to be playing in county theatrically?
So on April 1st, we're going to be opening at the shoot. Austin.
Sebastopol, I thought you said. Summerfield Cinemas in Santa Rosa.
Okay, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I know.
That's okay.
That
okay. Summerfield Cinemas in Santa Rosa. Yeah, that's our art and documentary house here in Sonoma County. So, perfect. Well, thank you very much for coming to the festival, Lisa Hurwitz, director of the Automat. You'll have a chance to see this film outside of the festival.
It's on
called
April 1st.
The
Starting
Automat
April 1st, yeah.
On April 1st. I'm Rick Love for Sonoma TV here at the 25th annual Sonoma International Film Festival.